Omele Rav Nachman the Rovo. Rav Nachman said the Rovo. High Kroh, the pasuk which we cited, which is a pasuk in Yecheskel, Reisha Bekoin Godel, the same Bekoin Hedrit. We quoted a pasuk. Let's go just look on Amar Aleph. Yecheskel says, Almono Grusha lo yikhu lehem linoshim. A widow or a divorcee, they should not take for themselves wives. Kim besulos mizera beis Yisrael. Only virgins. Mizera beis Yisrael. So that was the argument we discussed. We only discussed the end of the puzzle. It was a question we had before in the argument in Mishnah, that let's say you have both parents are gay, right? Is the daughter qualified to marry a kohen? Rav Yossi says yes. Rav Yossi says that even if both parents are converts, if they have a daughter after they convert, the daughter is qualified to marry a kohen. And the Gemara says we rule like Rav Yossi. Except after the Churban Abayis, the Kohanim, they accept upon themselves a certain stringency that they don't marry that kind of woman if the parents are both converts. Okay? However, if the kohen married that woman, it's considered valid. It's a valid marriage because the base halacha we do rule like Rav Yossi. Since we rule like Rav Yossi, we allow them to remain married. Is it preferable? It's not preferable.
But for sure,
two separate things. The person doesn't have a share in the land. Well, what's a gerim? The person has no share in the land. Right. If both parents were gerim, so how does he have a share in the land? He has no share in the land. We're talking about legitimacy. The child of two people, Gerim, the child is fully legitimate even to marry a kohen. The daughter is permitted to marry a kohen. That's Rav Yossi. According to the other opinions in the Mishnah, it's not this way. Right? One parent, minimally one parent has to be an original Jew. Right? That's what we spoke about. Well, everybody agrees that if the father is a Jew, original Jew, and the mother is a Gioris, the daughter is definitely qualified to marry a what? A kohen. Not order if both parents are converts, that's something else. We rule like Rav Yossi that even both parents are converts, the daughter is qualified to marry a kohen. Okay? We'll see. No, kohen gadol is something else. Well, kohen gadol would be permitted. It's only, for only says a widow and a divorcee. We'll see. Amalei Rav Nachman, the rabba, so this pasuk which we cited. In Yecheskel, High Kroh Reisha B'Kohen Gadol. The beginning of the pasuk speaks about they should not marry a widow. So who's not permitted to marry a widow? Only a Kohen Gadol. The ordinary Kohen is permitted to marry a widow. Wait. The Gemara discusses this. The Sefer B'Kohen Hedrit. And the pasuk concludes regarding Kohen Hedrit. So Rashi explains, the beginning says an almana grusha, they're not permitted to marry. Who's that speaking about? That's Kohen Gadol. Right? Almana, the speaking of almana grusha, they should not marry, that's the Kohen Gadol. What is the conclusion of the pasuk, the sefer? So Rashi says, save Kohen Hedjit, the komar besulos mizer beis Yisrael, v'almana ashatia almana mekohen yikohu. So originally, the almono mimiyuchos haroi hasi lekuna. Get the dorishle rebuild the kamod. Then I will see him. Okay, we'll wait a little bit. We'll see. We'll get into the gemara exactly. Tosas on this. So Rava says Rav Nachman, is that the way we interpret the pasuk? The beginning of pasuk is kohen gadol. The conclusion is a kohen hedjit. Omalei ein. You know, it's interesting. The gemara says that we had a gemara in Shabbos. You know, Yecheskel, the book of Yecheskel is very complicated, but it's just a simple understanding. So the Gemara says there were so many complications, based on the literal reading, they wanted to be gonies, said Yecheskel. They wanted to just put it away, because based on the if you read it, just literally, it seems to be contrary to halacha. Certain things there which do not conform with what halacha is, and the stringencies and many things. So it says that there was a person that he went to his attic, and they had to expend 300 barrels of oil, and
Hilde resolved all the contradictions in Sefer Yechezkel. They did not cease studying it to elucidate all different aspects of the book of Yechezkel, and they weren't going to do it. The Zochos and Yishmael Tov, that person is remembered for good, was because of him, the book of Yechezkel was never hidden away, was never put away. So here also, we have Psukim and Yechezkel, which seem to be that even an ordinary Kohen is not permitted to marry an Almona. It's only limited to what? To the Kohen Gadol. So that's what he's saying. Well, at the beginning of the Pasuk speaking about a Kohen Gadol, the conclusion being about a Kohen Hedrick. The Gemara is going to explain this in a moment. Omar Leyein, he says yes. The Koskor Ahochi. Omar Leyein. Dichsiv, he says, where do we find such a thing? Something similar, not in Yechezkel. Dichsiv, we left off over here. V'ner Elokim Terem Yichveh. Ushmul Shochi Beichel Hashem. Now, the menorah, where was the menorah located in the Mishkan? Mishkan Shiloh, in any Mishkan. In the Hechel. The covered sanctuary, from the location. Right? Covered sanctuary. The chotzeh, the courtyard, which was where the Mizbech HaChitzon was, the outer altar, which is called Mizbech HaOlah. Mizbech HaOlah, that was in the courtyard, open to the sky. The menorah, the shulchan, and the Mizbech HaZov was in the covered sanctuary. The menorah was to the south, the gold table was to the north, and in the middle was the incense. Mizbech, right? The golden Mizbech. That's Mizbech HaZov, that was in the middle. Okay? So, it says Shmuel's mother, Chana, she had made a commitment to Hashem that if Hashem was her child, she would dedicate that child to Hashem. Old enough, she brought him to the Mishkan Shiloh, and he dedicated his life. He was there. Eli HaKohen was the Kohen Gadol at the time. So it says, and this is all of a sudden starting to hear voices. He became a Navi, a prophet, when he was a young boy. Shmuel HaNavi became a prophet. So it says, where was he lying in the Mishkan? It says, Ner Elokim Terem Yichveh. The Ner Elokim, that's the menorah. Before it was extinguished, Ushmuel Shochei Beichel Hashem. Shmuel was lying in the sanctuary of God. Said Morris, how could that be? The only person who's permitted to sit, even sit, forget about lying, is only if you're from the Davidic line. If you're a king from the Davidic line, you're the only person that's permitted to sit in the Echel, in the Azora, in the sanctuary. No one else is permitted to sit there. So how was Shmuel, who was a Levi, how was he permitted to lie there? Since he lied in the Echel Hashem, it was given at Sinai, but it's not in any way referenced or alluded to in the text. But the halacha which we see there was only the Davidic one. Not because Shaul was not a permanent king. He didn't know he wasn't permanent. He believed initially he was. Lineage of kings would be from him, the line of kings, but it wasn't. I mean, we still have Mashiach from Yosef. I mean, he's the anointed, right? The first Mashiach, he will wage the battle against the Armageddon. That's Mashiach from Yosef.
I'm not sure because.
See, the only person who's permitted to be anointed, once David became king, any other king, he had Malki Yisrael, he had kings of Israel, they weren't anointed. He weren't permitted to anoint them. If you anoint a commoner, even if he's a king, it's considered the person's liable for Koris. He's liable for spiritual incision. He was anointed, but the Gemara differentiates. Nobody differentiates. Shmuel, he was anointed with an earthenware vessel, Shaul, and he was with a keren, with a horn. The oil was in the horn. He was in a earthenware jug. A horn, it extends itself. It symbolically, because the horn, it continues, right?
elongated. So that the elongated shape of the horn indicates that his malchus is nimshach. It's going to be forever. The malchus based on it. I'm not sure what the malchus shina was. Is it anointed? Or if the one who's anointed was meant to continue, his line's meant to continue to be the king? I'm not sure. See, he was never there long enough. See, the only time this comes up is with Hakim. With Hakim, the king sits in the sanctuary when he reads Mishnah Torah. And as I mentioned on Friday, that's why Yerucham ben Nevat, that was his ego, caused him to actually introduce idolatry. Because when he would come to the Hakim, the Melech Yehuda would sit and he'd have to stand, so that's going to reveal, expose him that he's not the authentic king. One second, let me finish. Because of the ceremonies. Okay? So, see, actually, he destroyed Klal Yisrael because of his own ego. And it says that the Yerucham ben Nevat was a level of Torah sage. No one was able to hold up a candle to him. That's how great he was. But nevertheless, because of his ego, he was willing to destroy Klal Yisrael. He was Choti Matis Arabi. This is a famous word from Chaim Shmulevitz. Morris says that Hashem says to Yerucham ben Nevat, comes to him and says, you, Ben Yishai, and I will be strolled in the Garden of Eden. Are you agreeable to that? Wait a second. He says to Hashem, what did he say? He says, Ben Yishai, you and I will stroll. So God reverted the order. He says, I'm not interested. Hear this? If Ben David is going to walk before him in Gan Eden, he prefers to go to Gan Eden. This is a Gemara in Sanhedrin. Okay, here. So, which Chaim Shmulevitz said, but Hashem said, the first time he said it to him, he says, David, he said, you, David, and I. Then he says, by the way, what did you say? He says, no, David, you and I. So he says, what do you have to hear? He heard it the first place. The first was really self-consuming himself. He wants to hear it the second time. Of course, he expressed his ego, which was a disrespect. Hashem says, no, now you're second. Second, am I going? That's a famous word from Chaim Shmulevitz. Why? He was only a king for 2.5 years. Saul. He was only a king for 2.5 years. Saul was a king for 2.5 years. He was a king for no. He was a king for 40 years. Okay, I'm not getting into the dates. You discuss it with Moshe. Okay. He was in Hebron, he came to Yerushalayim. They speak about the calculation of years. Shmuel's a Levi. Shmuel's a Levi. No, Shmuel's a Levi. Said, therefore, how was he able to lie in the sand? So the Merzgenim, his atosis as well, he was a halacha of Kochi Kadoshim, Chatos, could only be by a Kohen. Only a male Kohen. Oshom, only by a male Kohen. Even the women are permitted to eat certain parts of other Kohen, like Shlomim, the Chosin, the Shok, the breast and the thigh that goes to the Kohen, of the carbon, like the Shlomim, the women are permitted to eat that. In Yerushalayim. See, in Yerushalayim, it's not limited to the sanctuary. The Kochi Kadoshim, which is Oshom and Chatos, the guilt offering and sin offering could only be in the sanctuary, and only by Zichri Kohen, only the males. The women are not permitted to eat that, okay? Now, the Gemara says that when they would eat the kochim, they would actually put seasoning on it. They would eat it with mustard seed. With mustard seed. Why? Because it says in Moshe, when you eat kochim, it has to be eaten in the tastiest way. It's respect for the kochim. It's not you're eating it where you have no interest in eating. It should be something which is desirable to the one who eats it. Therefore, it's seasoned. You seed it with chardev. Okay? Because the Torah says, l'moshcho. It's l'gedula. You have to give it a certain degree of
respect. It's kosher, it's just not ordinary food. So the Tosa says, did they sit? No. Did the Kohanim, when they ate the kosher in the Azor, did they sit? Did they sit? So the Tosa says they sat. So the Tosa says, for the Ein Yeshiva Bazor Ella Malchi Beisdovi, right? Ein Yeshiva Bazor Ella Malchi Beisdovi, the Levod. Said, how did the Kohanim, how did they eat the kosher? How did they sit? When they had the chatos and the yosham in the sanctuary, the halacha mishnah is the only permitted person is permitted to sit in the sanctuary. There's only malchei beis dovid levod. That's Tosa's question. Tosa's answer is that's the moshe. That's part of the avoda. The Gemara says kohanim ochlin bayim skaprim. The Gemara says when the kohen consumes the kodshim, that's part of the atonement. That's part of the atonement process. And since the Torah says when you eat kodshim, that's the moshe. It's not on the run. You sit when you eat rather than stand. It's not appropriate to eat standing if it's something which is substantial, something which has special value. Therefore, halachically, because that's part of the avodas hakodesh. So we say you're not permitted to sit means sitting, which is not related to avoda. Reading of the Mishnah Torah is not avoda. He's supposed to, he gathers the Klal Yisrael. It's interesting, even though it says that it's mishtachim. Over the tzufim and mishtachmas revochim, they prostrated themselves when they heard the Shem Hashem. We just said yesterday about avoda. They prostrated themselves in the azora. That's not called lying, and that's not called sitting. That's prostration to that's avoda. That's avoda that you permitted. But here it says here Shmuel was just lying, and also he started to hear voices. It was the beginning of the divorce. Doesn't make a difference. David asked the question, was Shaul permitted? Since Shaul was the anointed king at that time. But there's Halacha Mishmi Sinai. This was given at Sinai already. Has nothing to do whether the Davidic line or not. It's not in place. That means nobody was permitted to sit. Nobody. Definitely if you're a Levi, you're not permitted. Right? Maybe Shaul was permitted, but anybody outside was not permitted. So if he's not permitted, had the Shmuel. No, but you read the pasuk. That's what Rav Nachman is showing you. He's showing from this pasuk that even though, as the pasuk reads literally, it seems to be he was in the Azora, it's impossible to say that he couldn't have been, because you're not permitted. So how do we interpret the pasuk? Elo. So how do we read the pasuk? Ner Elokim terem yichve b'hechla Hashem. Where was the Ner Elokim? Where was the menorah? Where was the ongoing candle of God burning? That was in the Hechel Hashem. That was the covered sanctuary. Shmuel Shochev b'mkoma. Where was Shmuel? In his where? There was a location with the Levium. That like a dormitory area. Subterranean location. That's where they would sleep. So that's where Shmuel was sleeping. At the Levium. He was with the Levium. Subterranean. There were locations for people to do the bodily function. No, it's not. It's not a proof. You interpret Sukkim this way. Well, he show over here. It's also the only way. We'll see in a moment. It says Valmona because he's going to show again how the pasuk cannot be read literally. It says Almona Ashetia Almona Mikoein Yiku. It says the widow who's a widow of a Kohen, that's the one they should marry. Wait a second. Someone asked, "Mikoin yikhu mikoin," right? Yikhu mikoin ain. Mikoin yikhu mikoin ain. Yisrael lo. I mean, only a widow of a kohen is permitted to a kohen, to an ordinary kohen, to an ordinary kohen. But a widow from who's a widow from a Yisrael is not permitted to a kohen. Hochi kohen. Mikoin yikhu. What is that? What is Mikoin Yiku? Yiku doesn't mean Mishar Kohanim Yiku, meaning the Kohen Gadol is not permitted to marry. But when it says Mikoin Yiku means ordinary Kohanim, they're permitted to take from anyone. Let's take a look at Rashi.
Is that possible? Harei lo huza kohen hedjin al amona. He was never forewarned not to marry an almona. So what is it? How do you read? Mishar kohen yichud lefrushei also. The kohen hedjin kohen. We're speaking about kohen hedjin. Welcome. Almona ashetia almona afil Yisrael mishar kohanim. She'edu kohen godol yichud also. The woman who's a widow, even of Yisrael, regarding other Kohanim, they're permitted to marry her. That, when it says me, Kohen means the Kohanim are permitted to marry her. We have a problem there. It says Kohen, an Almona, and Grusha, they should not marry, but an ordinary Kohen is permitted to marry. So we're saying the widow is going on the ordinary Kohen. When it says me Kohanim, because the Kohen God can marry a widow from anyone. Is not permitted to marry a widow from anyone. An ordinary Kohen is permitted to marry a Kohen. So what does it mean, Kohanim? The Mekohanim means it's referring to the one who's not permitted to marry the Almona is only the Kohen Godel. But Mekohanim means, but if you're an ordinary Kohen, regardless of who she's a widow from, you're permitted, even if she's a widow, of a non-Kohen. It's associated with that ritual possible. Same pasuk. Just it's the continuation. Okay. Tanya Nami Yochi, we have a brisa which supports this. Mikoin yikhu bishar kohanim yikhu. When it says mikoin yikhu, doesn't mean the widow should be taken. The widow of a kohen they should take, but rather bishar kohanim yikhu. Mikoin needs other kohanim. Rav Yehuda Omer min amasiyin lekuna. Rav Yehuda said earlier that if you have an ordinary Jew married to a Gioris, the daughter is not a Chalola, correct? But if the father is a Ger, married to a ordinary Jewish woman, the daughter is a Chalola. The father is a Ger, and the mother is an ordinary Jew. Right? Everybody agrees that if the father is a Jew, original Jew, and the mother is a Gioris, the daughter is permitted to go. What about if the father is a Ger and the mother is a Jewish, original Jew? The daughter, according to Rav Yehuda, the daughter is a Chalola. That's Rav Yehuda's position. We don't rule like Rav Yehuda. Rav Lezer ben Yaakov says if either parent is an original Jew, that's sufficient, that the daughter should not be a Chalola. Rav Yossi, as I said, even if both parents are Ger, the child is permitted to recover. We'll see. Rav Yehuda Omer min amasim lekuna yikhu. When it says Mikoin means only those who are permitted to marry the Kohen, only that type of woman are you permitted to marry. The widow of that woman. So if let's say you have a Ger. A Ger's daughter, a Ger marries an ordinary Jewish woman who has a daughter. What is the daughter? The daughter is a Chalola. So what's his wife? His wife becomes, is also a Chalola. If the daughter is a Chalola, so what is the wife? The wife's a Chalola. Correct? That's Rav Yehuda. So Rav Yehuda says, which widow is the ordinary Kohen permitted to marry? The one who's Masih Lekuna. If he's permitted to marry the daughter of that woman, then he's permitted to marry that Almona. But if he's not permitted to marry the daughter of that woman, such as the case where the husband was a Ger, because if the daughter is a Chalol, that means the mother is a Chalol. Correct? See, Mer says, Rav Yehuda L'tame. Rav Yehuda is consistent with this position, the way he's interpreting the Pasuk. That's Rav Yehuda. That's the way Rav Yehuda reads the pasuk. This is Rav Yehuda consistent with his position. The Omer Bas Ger Zocher, the Bas Cholo Zocher. The daughter of a Ger, although the wife is an original Jew, the daughter is considered what? Is considered a Chalova. The Bas Cholo Zocher. Koshet Anosei Bito. If you're permitted to marry the daughter, Atanosei Almonosa. You're permitted to marry the widow. Because if the daughter is a Chalova, what's the mother? The mother's a Chalola. Kosha Iato no se bito. But if you're not permitted to marry the daughter, such as with the father is a Ger, although the woman, the mother is an original Jew, Iato no se amonoso, you're not permitted to marry the widow. Okay? Rav Yossi Omer. Av Ger Shinos Gyos. Rav Yossi says, even if both parents are Gerim, and the child was conceived after they both converted, the mother and father, the daughter is permitted to marry a Kohen. The daughter is not a Chalom. That's Rabbi Yossi. Om Rav Amnunim Shmei De'ula, Rav Amnunim says, Halachik Rav Yossi. We rule like Rav Yossi. V'chein Omar Rabba Bar Bachona, Halachik Rav Yossi. Rav Bachona says, we rule like Rav Yossi, that even if both parents are converts, but if the child was sown, as Moshe Zalman Aleph, after they were Jewish, the child was a kosher Jew. No, it just reinforces that that's the way we rule. Rabbi Ruchon is a problem with Rabbi Yochanan. Okay? No, Ula was also, they both Talmidim. Rabbi Ula was a Talmud of Rabbi Yochanan, and so was Rabbi Ruchon. We both students of Rabbi Yochanan. Rabbi Yochanan definitely is Rabbi Yochanan's position. We rule like Rabbi Yossi. Umiyom Shechor Beis HaMikdosh. However, after the Churban HaBayis, Nogu Kohanim Silsu Batzman, they took on a certain degree of stringency, meaning Rashi says malo, like we find the malos pekochim, malos pekuna. Even on a Torah level, certain things are permitted to a kohen. They elevated themselves. That the kohen should, because Talmud of Mishnah, everybody saw the specialness of the kohen. He was the only one who was qualified to officiate. After the churban, how did a kohen? Firstly, a kohen, yet you have to give him some degree of prestige. How do you give? Not everyone is available. And even though halachically it's permitted, he has to have a higher, a different level of refinement, of pedigree. His pedigree, he can only marry a woman of greater pedigree. So that emphasizes the specialness of the kohen. But again, it was only to give them a special degree of recognition. On a Torah level, they're telling him, yeah, but we'll see in a moment. Rebbe Elazar ben Yaakov, so how did they conduct themselves after the Churban? Like Rebbe Elazar ben Yaakov, that was what? As long as one parent is Jewish, it's irrelevant. Whether the father's original Jew or the mother, the daughter's permitted to marry a Kohen. Okay? Everybody agrees if the father's a Jew, original Jew, the mother's a Geras, that's never a question. What about if the mother, father was a Ger, and the mother was original Jew? Right? That was the argument. That's Rabbi Elazar ben Yaakov. He says yes. So how did they conduct themselves after the Churban? Like Rabbi Elazar ben Yaakov. That even if the father was a Ger, as long as the mother was Jewish, it's fine. Before the Churban, even if both parents were Ger. Okay? One second. Om Rav Nachman Om Alihuna. Now, if you like to ask a good question, both Ula and Rabbi Chaim, they were after the Churban. So what do we have to discuss? What the halach is? This is the difference. Amar Rav Nachman, Amali Huna, Boli Molech. If a person comes to Kohen consults, who am I permitted to marry? Mor Melech Rav Elazar ben Yaakov. He says, as long as one of the parents are original Jew, the wife is considered available to you. Nosa, factually, post facto, if he married the daughter of parents, both of them were Gerim, Emotiv Sabimenu, Rav Yossi. So the basic halacha is like Rav Yossi. If he marries her, it's a valid marriage. The court does not even suggest that he should divorce her. However, preferably, one of the parents should be a Jew, original Jew. Okay? So therefore, that's what is important. Halacha, we rule like Rav Yossi for this situation. Sharon, 100% Sharon. Could have multiple sexual relationships before she converts. She converts, you know, here she's got king of Shinola, it's like a newborn person. Her children, she marries even another Ger, 100%. The daughter's kosher, Mary Cohen. Right? It's irrelevant who she cohabited with when she wasn't Jewish. A Jewish woman cohabits with a goy, with a mom's anything, her child will be a defiled child. That's exactly what we're saying. That's for a Kohen Gadol. For a Kohen Gadol.
No. I'll give you an example. No. But what about she was pre-three, before three? Why? Why? We don't rule like she's a kohen. We say even if she converts before three, she's not permitted to a kohen. She's not permitted to a kohen. A gioris or converts, should not be, of course, no. So whatever it is. But let's say she's raped. Let's say if a girl converts before three, now she's an adult. She converted before she was three, she's raped. Does he have to pay knas? He's 12 years old. She pays knas. She pays penalty. That's a psula, was raped. Okay, let's begin the next mission. We have a few minutes. Omer benize mamzer, enu nemon. A person says he committed incest. Sister's pregnant, and he says, I'm the father of that child. Is he believed? It's a beni. Zem mamzer. It's my child, the child's a mamzer. Right? He was conceived in incest. Enu nemon. Even if the mother agrees, she concurs with the man. She's not believed. Why should she believe? So the Gemara is going to say, because he assumes that. He assumes she has no relations with anyone else. But she knows. So it's a he, maybe the reason why we don't believe him is because he doesn't really know 100%. But she definitely knows that the conception was what? She only had relations, let's say, with him. Nevertheless, she's still not believed. You have to have two witnesses. Unless you have two witnesses to confirm that the child's a mamzer, he's not believed, and even she's not believed. That was the midwife. We spoke about the midwife. And there was one question, that was only rabbinical. It's only rabbinical. She may not know. No. She'll know. Over there, had to do with the children getting mixed up. Right, whose child was it? The midwife is there. She delivers the children. Okay. I feel shnei modim alu uber should be meo. Mamzer in the morning. I'm going to say something interesting. We had a principle, if you remember. You have a piece of meat. It's a question whether it's kosher or not. And the eidechel comes says the meat is not kosher. Right. Let's say a person eats meat. Eats a piece of meat. Yachud would say, I told him the meat wasn't kosher. You give him malchus. Doesn't get malchus. Let's say an Eid Echad comes to Bezdin and says, this piece of meat is not kosher. And they rule not based on his testimony as an Eid Echad, it's not kosher. Subsequently, the person wants to eat the meat and is forewarned not to eat the meat because the meat is not kosher. Is he subject to malchus? Even though the origin of the fact is a single witness, Eid Echad, he gets malchus. Why? Because that's called chusa, because it's been established. So you could say a child that's born, the presumption is the mother has a cheskes kashrus. It's presumed the child's a kosher Jew. So now if you want to in any way affect that presumed status, not believe. What about if she's pregnant, she hasn't yet given birth? So it hasn't been established yet. So maybe you should believe. You should believe either he or she. Nevertheless, it says, afilu al-uber shemeya imam z'enu nemon. Even if it's a fetus, they want to testify that the child that she's pregnant with is illegitimate, also not believed. Although the child was never born as a child. So you're not affecting the status of someone who was established to have a kosher status. No, it's not a human being. It's not a human being. It's not establishing a body. There's no reason to test. If you want to play safe. No. Ain't on them. He's not believed whatsoever. Not believed. We'll discuss it. No, we're not finished yet. Leave you tomorrow open. Rebbe Yoshi, remember with the World Trade Center, they had identified DNA. Rebbe Yoshi ruled that based on DNA testing, there's a confirmation that.
that if it remains in person, the wife's permitted to be married. That's what we should do. DNA is sufficient to establish fact that it's the remains of this particular person, and therefore the wife's permitted to be married. What if they couldn't find the DNA? That's a problem. It's not simple. How do you prove that to her husband? Maybe he wasn't in, maybe he was elsewhere. She's an Aguna. I'm just mentioning only regarding DNA what David's bringing up. I told you it was just a few months ago. A woman gave birth to the twins, and each child had a different DNA. Because it was two ovums, and they were fertilized by two different men.